I have the privilege this morning of leading off our panel and sharing with you a little bit about what is being done. And as the governor alluded to, he started touring the state and visiting with businesses in January of this year. And during those visits, it became very evident that there was a common concern focusing around workforce in our state. And the summit that you're sitting at today is a result of those conversations. We found that we needed to engage more people, invite more people to the table to be a part of not only the discussion on what issues are we facing, but also on offering suggestions for solutions. So the programs we're going to talk to you about this morning are in place, but that doesn't mean they're perfect. So if you have thoughts on any of these we talk about as the panel, please this afternoon offer some suggestions on how we can improve them as well. The Cabinet Work Group for SD WINS, which was launched in 2012, and this is a comprehensive program that brought together all sectors of state government. It includes representation from those of us at the table and others that were introduced in the room. And there are actually 20 different programs that fall under the SD WINS heading. And those all have a common thread of the goals are four. One is to prepare our youth. Two is to train individuals for skilled jobs. Three is to improve access to rural health care. And the fourth one is to bring new South Dakotans into the state, which is the recruitment arm. And we are going to talk about not all 20 of those programs, but touch on some highlights this morning of some of them. So joining me today will be, as David mentioned, Melody and Jack and Doneen, and as well the other two members of that team are Mark and Pat, who are also in the room. With that, I'm going to go ahead and start talking about the Department of Labor and Regulation programs. And I have to admit, the governor took a couple of my jokes, but I'm just going to have to improvise and adapt. He asked for a show of hands of how many of you are familiar with the Dakota Roots program. So just, I didn't get to see the perspective. So if you'd heard of Dakota Roots before this morning, please go ahead and raise your hand again. And you know, that's really amazing because Dakota Roots was started with absolutely no marketing dollars. And it was all word of mouth. It was grassroots efforts. We did things like handed out flyers at homecoming parades or 4th of July parades or pheasant hunters. We were greeted at the airports. And yet, even with very limited resources going to the marketing of that, almost everybody in the room raised their hands and acknowledged that they were familiar with it. And this is a program that recruits individuals with a tie to the state back to the state. And it has been very successful. Just in our active job seekers that we have listed every month, that caseload has grown to 3,858 on average in 2013. So what that means to you as a business is we have a pool of about 4,000 individuals at any given time that have indicated an interest to come back to the state to live and work. And that's why it is so important that you're listing your jobs with us so those individuals know the opportunities that are available. In just 2013 alone, 756 individuals moved back to the state to accept employment through that program. And that may not seem like a very large number, but if you look at it a couple of different ways, that's almost two people a day that are returning to the state. And the average age of those individuals is about 36. Look at what the family demographics of a 36-year-old typically would be. There's probably a spouse, and there are probably children. So we're growing our population not just by that 756, but you can probably multiply that by three or four, and therefore growing our citizens at a very good rate. Dakota Roots, as I mentioned, was started with very little investment for the marketing side of it, but a couple years ago, the legislature did give us some marketing dollars. And we have found that since we've had the ability to do some of the events like the governor talked about in his remarks, our annual registrations are up 89%. Our annual job placements are up 66%. And some of the examples of marketing that we've done are digital engagement, direct mailings, and disruptive marketings. And as the governor mentioned also, a really big component is the referral of family and friends. So to kind of flip his comment, how many of you have family that are living out of state? How many of you want some of them to come back? Not quite as many hands go up, but you know, think about it. If you do have a family member, I have a brother that's worked out of state his entire life. He's almost to the point where he's going to retire. He's an electrician. perfect example, did the 2-year degree, I did the 4-year degree. He's always made twice as much money as I have. But he's gonna retire young and wants to return to South Dakota. And there's really a place for individuals like that also in our economy to come back and take jobs in some capacity. With Dakota Roots, the other program that we've had on the recruitment side is New South Dakotans. And New South Dakotans was a unique program. What I like about this program is it shows we had the courage to try something new. And what this program was designed to do was to give employers the option of using a private recruitment firm and work to bring people into the state. And we have had 150 people return to the state through New South Dakotans, and there are currently 44 businesses that are using it. However, the legislature this year carefully looked at that program and they did decline funding to fund it into the future. So we're in a winding down phase of this, and it will run through December of this year, and then we'll be finished with that. But it also tells me that we have the opportunity with the workforce issues to try new things. And I like that if we try something and it's not quite right, we don't stick with it, that we say, okay, this wasn't quite the right route, let's try something new. And this illustrates that we have that ability to regroup, rethink, and rechannel our efforts. The last program that I want to talk about under Department of Labor initiatives is the National Career Readiness Certificate. And we refer to this by the NCRC, and hopefully in Rapid City, a lot of you have heard about this because we have some really good Department of Labor and Regulation staff who have been actively promoting this. But what this is, it's a National Career Readiness Certificate. It's an assessment that measures an individual's workforce skills. It's not an academic assessment. So if you take this assessment, it tells you if you have the foundational skills to enter into employment, and it matches you with employer demands. And it does things like assesses reading, problem solving, critical thinking, and math reasoning. So very different skills. And we have partnered with the Department of Education the past year and have assessed over 2,000 high school juniors and seniors. And we really debated at the onset of this program, should we offer this assessment to just those that don't take the regular ACT and offer this as an alternative? And then I think a very wise decision was made, no, because that's making an assumption that some students are college bound and some students are maybe not college bound. And this assessment is for individuals who are work bound. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm a parent, and I hope that my children are all going to have a job at the end of the day. And so I don't think it's a bad thing that we're preparing all of our youth for the world of work. They're just going to take very different routes to get there. And so with that, we're going to continue next year and increase our goals of those students that will be assessed and working towards this credential for the workforce. So with that, the governor visited quite a bit about making sure that our youth are prepared and making good decisions that are based on information. And in the Department of Labor and Regulation, we realize fully that there's no right or wrong path to that world of work. You may go straight into the workforce after high school. You may do on-the-job training. You may go into the military. You may go to a 2-year, 4-year post-secondary institution. All of those are a good path, but at the end of the day, the goal is still work. And I just have to share with you, this is really a case of do as I say and not as I do, because my 18-year-old, well, he's 26 now, but when he graduated from high school, his expressed career goal was to be a pirate. And we sent him off to the university where he decided instead to study philosophy. We now think that pirate would have been a much better option, as he probably would have had better and more opportunities for employment. But with that, it's now my pleasure to turn the mic over to Melody Schopp from the Department of Education. Thank you.
I want to give you some context for Meadow, South Dakota. Do any of you know where Meadow's at? Okay. Well, let me tell you how isolated Meadow is. There was just an article in the Argus Leader about, it's probably been a month ago now, that highlighted Meadow, South Dakota, and it's infamous for one thing. It's the furthest from any McDonald's in the intercontinental USA. And there was a map to prove it. So it showed all these little dots of all the McDonald's across the United States, and Meadow is the furthest, 145 miles. So that gives you a context for our isolation, if anything. So it gives you an idea of where I live in the other part of my life. As Marcia mentioned, we do really believe that education has to play an important role in workforce. And I think for many years, we might not have thought about what our purpose was. I think we had a good goal, which was to educate and get kids graduate from high school. But the more important role is that not only do we graduate them, but we make sure that they're ready for that next phase of life, which is to be college, career, and life ready. So we do take a really active role in this opportunity in preparing our youth. And I'm going to talk about some of the things that we're going to do and that we are doing at this point in time. The first phase of that is getting kids to really understand and explore the opportunities that are out there. I don't know about you, but perhaps I fell into, luckily, the career path that I took. But through a program that we call SD My Life, and I'm looking at Mark Wilson, who really was the brainchild of this opportunity. And the SD My Life is a website that gives students an opportunity in a number of different ways to research career options through where they take interest and aptitude assessments to begin with. They explore careers, they look at post-secondary opportunities, whether it's a two-year institution in South Dakota or a four-year opportunity. They create, and it's required in South Dakota, that every student creates a personal learning plan where they can look at the courses and classes that they take aligned to what they're interested in doing once they leave high school. And then the other piece that we're adding on and expanding is a connection to business and industry to be able to find what are those careers that are out there that are available in South Dakota and that provide good options for kids after high school. So really this portal is a wealth of information that we are connecting students with. It is an option not only for students but for parents to get involved, for you to be able to see where the student is interested and what the options are in South Dakota. So really an exciting way which kids can look at the 16 different career clusters that are available at all spectrums of the careers that are out in South Dakota as well as across the United States. So by providing students those opportunities while they're in high school to get a jump start on post-secondary, it really leads to those post-secondary successes. So I'm going to talk about, we have a menu of options in K-12. We also have some other career exploration, things that we want to get kids connected with. And finally, some post-secondary success things going forward. In this menu of options, the state over the last few years and the legislature has provided some funding for us to help kids to leave high school ready for that next phase and whatever it's going to be. And one of the things that we've been working on over the last couple years is in the area of remedial coursework. Right now, if a student is identified and they take the ACT and they're identified as not meeting a certain benchmark, they are notified by the Department of Education in collaboration with the Board of Regents and receive a letter that tells them while they're still a senior in high school and says, you know, if you don't do something about this in your senior year, you're going to end up taking a remedial course once you get to college. And this remedial course that students typically take takes up a semester, costs about $900. They get no credit for that. And what's even more interesting about this is that when these students are tracked, if they're required to take a remedial course in college, their likelihood of completing is decreased dramatically. So what we've done is we've taken a really active, proactive role in trying to mitigate this from happening. We have collaborated with the Board of Regents and are offering these same remedial courses and opportunities while they're still in high school. So we're really encouraging high schools to get involved in this. We're moving it down, no cost to the student. We're saving them time, we're saving them money, and giving them so that they really are prepared to take that next step into entering either a technical institute or a four-year college. Another great thing that we are really, really excited about is our dual credit funding that has been given to the state. Providing dual credit, when we say dual credit, that means a student can get both high school credit and either technical institute credit or college credit at the low rate of only $40. So the state picks up the additional cost for that. And we have a whole list of approved courses. In fact, just before I came up here today, I was looking at everything that Rapid City is doing along with Western Dakota, as well as with our collaboration with our four-year institutions, a huge list of almost 50-some courses that students right here in Rapid City can take while they're in high school. So some of those can lead to getting those general education courses out of the way once they get into a four-year institution. The other exciting thing is the dual credit here in Rapid City is a direct connection to Western Dakota Technical Institute. So they can get some of those courses and really get some of that out of the way prior to entering and connects them. So you think about what dual credit does. The reason I'm so excited about it is if we want to keep kids in South Dakota, they take a course, they get a transcript, it shows that they're already enrolled in either Western Dakota Tech or at SDSU or Black Hills State University, the likelihood of them staying here is even better because they've already got credit behind them. So great opportunity, and this year we're really kicking it off. We've had a ton of interest already from the time that we've announced this of the number of students who are enrolled over this next year. I'm hoping I'm going to have to go back to the legislature next year and ask for more dollars to further support that program. Advanced placement is something else we've been doing in South Dakota for some time, but the unique part about the funding that's provided from the state is that advanced placement courses are being offered at no cost to students in even our most rural areas. So advanced placement are courses that give kids the rigor that they really need to be successful in college, and also gives them, if they pass a certain exam at a certain level, college credit as well. The AP typically, prior to the funding that we were given, was offered in some of our larger districts where they had either enough staff or that they had enough students to fill the courses. These are offered online. They're taught by some of the very best teachers across the state of South Dakota, have been extremely successful in what they've been able to offer. So again, these three opportunities give students that jump start once they leave high school in South Dakota. Next area I want to talk about is in the area of career exploration. I talked a little bit about using SD My Life as a piece of that, but there are some things that we're trying to do to get kids to make sure, are they making the right choice? We talked about the pirate. There wasn't a whole lot of things for him to probably explore in South Dakota, but for each of us, we want to make sure that our kids make that right choice. And so one of the ways we do that is through expanding the number of current technical education opportunities. Again, I was just reading through what Rapid City offers here. Rapid City has a huge list of career and technical education. And I bet for a lot of you, as well as for me, when you think back about what career and technical education, remember vocational education years ago? It was probably ag, or it was welding, or it was what we used to call home ec. It's no longer called home ec, by the way, anymore. It's family consumer science. Very limited opportunities for what we offered. Today, there are lists of things that students can do, and really what this does is it helps kids to know, is this the right thing for me? So everything that you can imagine that gives kids those hands-on opportunities, doesn't matter what they're going to do, but tons of opportunities, and Rapid City is a really good example of offering those for students as well. Another way in which kids can explore to see what does it really feel like, so maybe all the way along they thought, you know, I'd really like to be somebody who's going to be an EMT, but they've only seen it from afar. Our career cluster camps are an opportunity for kids to spend a day long exploring what does that career look like. And it gives them the opportunity to have, from all levels in that career cluster, to have that hands-on opportunity and be engaged with professionals in the field and get that feel for what that's like. Internships provide a really valuable experience for students. We were just the other day, was interviewed, in fact, about internships that we just offer in the state of South Dakota. We have interns within the Department of Education, in fact, who are education majors who get to see that other side. But when we're talking about internships that can also connect with business and industry, where students are able to follow business people as well as in their career choice and interest area, and maybe find that either is the best thing that they could ever do, or maybe something that they thought they were interested in but really are not. So really a connection again, and we also find that with the internships, it connects them to South Dakota employers. That's what we want to do. We want to get great kids to be employed and stay in the state of South Dakota. And finally, we talked about the NCRC, or the National Career Readiness Certificate. We are excited about this. In fact, we've built it into our accountability system. We feel very strongly in the Department of Education that we have a responsibility to get kids college, career, and life ready. And we want every student to have those soft skills that are make them employer ready. And when I talk to business people in the field, the one thing they're telling me is we need kids to not only have the content knowledge, but we need them to come to work, we need them to show up, we need them to be on time. And that NCRC are some of those soft employability skills are important to all of you as employers in the state of South Dakota. Post-secondary student success. One of the things that we were really excited about that has happened in the last couple years is that we have been able to offer what we call the critical needs scholarships. These have been given to our technical institutes in the amount of $125,000 over the next 3 years. Some great things about this scholarship is not only does it give students the funding to be able to attend the institute in the amount of $5,000 for a two-year program or $2,500 for a one-year program, but the part that I think is really powerful is that the student has to agree to work in South Dakota for up to 3 years. Again, connecting them to South Dakota once they're here. They're in high demand areas of transportation, construction, utilities, engineering, manufacturing, IT, making sure that we are meeting the workforce needs in South Dakota. So we've had those hands-on opportunities previously, but then making sure that we can help kids to get into institutions here in South Dakota. And I know that Dr. Warner is going to talk further about what our four institutions are doing to make that happen. Another piece of that, and Dr. Warner could further explain this, South Dakota WINS is also working with public universities to increase student success and retention once they get there. Because we not only want to get kids to college, so we do a lot of things, you know, on what we've been talking about before, is preparing them to get out there. We got to make sure that we can keep them there, that they're successful and being retained and can graduate once they're there. So to accomplish this, the Regents system has redesigned approaches to remedial education and instruction, as well as an early alert system that gives them an opportunity to identify students early on if they need additional support. So those are some things that Dr. Warner can further explain if needed. Finally, I'd like to talk about some opportunities, some grant dollars that have been given across the state through our future funds. So the governor awarded a significant amount of dollars this past year to really support workforce in South Dakota. And I'm going to talk about those in three different areas. The Technical Institute has received, Technical Institutes have received what we call education equipment grants. What's exciting about these grants is that each technical institute, the four technical institutes in South Dakota, were able to look at what they needed specifically to upgrade their equipment to make sure that when they are instructing students that they're using the state-of-the-art equipment so that they can give businesses the confidence when those kids walk out of their door, or students or young people walk out of their door, that it truly is a highly trained workforce. This was awarded in the amount of close to $4 million, as you can see, and really an opportunity to make sure that our technical institutes offer the very best training and equipment that is used in the real world today. Secondly, future funds were given to, I talked about the critical needs scholarships, but one of the things I want to spend just a couple of moments talking about that we are very excited in the K-12 world is in the area of the governor's grants for career and technical education. And Rapid City was one of these that was awarded this grant. There was 12 different districts across the state because I think Rapid City was like the, you know, they were kind of like our shining star of what true collaboration is when we want to work between a public school district and one of our career and technical education programs. And then, even as importantly, if not more importantly, is to have the support of the community, which is what Rapid City has been able to bring. So the grant priorities in awarding these dollars in about $8.5 million was regional participation, which I just talked about, meeting and making sure it meets the South Dakota workforce needs, local commitment, cooperation with post-secondary in some sort of way, great collaboration. Again, you should see all the courses and collaboration between the Rapid City School District and Western Dakota Tech here. Partnership with business and industry, and finally, that it has to have a systems approach, that this just isn't a program that's going to go forward and die in a couple years. Want to make sure that those opportunities with these career and technical education grants are meeting those needs. Let me give you another example. There's a grant that was given up in the northwest corner, and I know about this because I used to teach up in that area. So for them to be able to offer career and technical education programs in some of those smaller districts, just having one teacher in that school district doesn't give them the wealth of experiences. So for a number of years, they've had trailers that have moved from district to district offering different types of programs. They've been there since I was teaching there, 30, 40 some years ago. They needed to be upgraded. So they applied for a grant and were given dollars to upgrade their trailers to be able to offer state-of-the-art equipment that will move from district to district to offer an opportunity as well. So again, all of these dollars that you see with the future fund dollars from the governor provide that strong foundation for further development of the programs that we see through South Dakota WINS. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Secretary Hollingsworth, and she will provide background on many of the efforts being made to improve access to rural health care in South Dakota.
This is the fourth workforce summit that we've done across the state this spring, and at more than one of those, people have looked at me and said, nice to see you, Doneen, but why is the Secretary of Health at a workforce summit? I'm sure the people in Rapid City are smart enough that you wouldn't ask that question, but in case there's anyone that's wondering, healthcare, the workforce, is something that is always a critical need in South Dakota. And in some parts of South Dakota, finding healthcare workers is much more difficult than others. The other reason that healthcare is one of the key components to South Dakota WINS is, as you know, as employers, one of the things that your employees, prospective employees, are looking for as they're coming to a community is quality health care. So that's why the Department of Health is pleased to be part of the group and why really improving access to especially rural health care is one of the key things that we're focusing on through the Workforce Initiative. A couple years ago, in the summer of 2012, Governor Dugard appointed a primary care task force. And this was a group made up of 24 different individuals, healthcare sector, of course, government, education, legislators, general public. And the charge to the group was to look at ways to provide some recommendations to ensure improved access of primary care providers. And primary care is defined as family medicine, internal medicine, pediatrics, and obstetrics and gynecology. Ensuring that we have improved access to primary care across the state. The need for primary care and the need for additional health care workers was something that the task force first focused on. And some of the data that I think is compelling is between 2010 and 2020, we will need over 8,000 more healthcare workers in our state. The average age of a South Dakota physician is 52, and almost one-third of our counties, 19, have no primary care physician practicing in that county. The thing that was really driven home for us on the task force is the very best chance that we have of getting more healthcare providers to practice here in our state is if they're raised here, if they're educated here, and if they have good training experiences here. And by training experiences, I mean things like residencies, internships, preceptorships, those clinical experiences. Our medical school at USD does a great job, and they do the statistics of retaining medical students in South Dakota by our med school are much better than a lot of other states. 40% of USD medical graduates end up practicing in primary care. 28% of them practice in rural areas. 37% practice in South Dakota. But here's the kicker. That's more than doubled, 78%, if they also go on from medical school and do a residency in South Dakota. So the next few slides, I'm going to just quickly share with you some of the things that the task force recommended, programs that have been implemented. We have to have patience. For instance, it takes a long time to train a physician, to go through medical school, to go through residency, to practice, and some of the other programs too. It takes a while, but we believe that these programs will have a profound impact on our healthcare workforce. One of the first things we looked at was the capacity. How many slots do we have enough training capacity for folks who are students in South Dakota, qualified South Dakota students, to get into things like nursing schools, medical school, PA school, nurse practitioner school, pharmacy school? We really found two areas where there was the greatest need. The task force made the recommendation, and the governor and the legislature supported those recommendations. The first one is really very significant. The number of slots at the School of Medicine have been increased by 15. 15 more physicians per year will be trained at our medical school. And take that times four then, because there's four years of medical school, there will be 60 more medical students in training by 2019. The other thing, The PA program, the number of slots were increased, and also importantly, the state has invested in paying for the preceptors who help to train physician assistants and nurse practitioners. Because the task force learned that when these students were in training, they were often doing preceptorships in our neighboring states, especially Nebraska and Iowa and Minnesota. And that's where they're going to end up practicing if they're doing that training with an out-of-state preceptor. So the focus was on getting them a preceptor, giving them a stipend, not a lot of money, but to do it and to keep the training in-state. Another focus of the primary care task force was quality rural experiences. The thought is, let's not force every student, every med student, every nursing student, every healthcare student to have a rural experience. Let's really focus on those students where we think we could make, who have an interest, maybe already have a background in rural, make sure that when they are in a rural area, that experience is quality. So there's two key programs. The first one is called the Frontier in Rural Medicine. The acronym is FARM. And basically what that is, this is a significant investment in state resources. Thank you to the legislators in the room. For supporting this proposal. But this provides basically a rural training track for six third-year medical students. In their third year, they spend 9 months of clinical training in a rural community. And this it's a very competitive process. My staff has been part of choosing those students, along, of course, with the medical school and another a team of folks. And they've told me how impressed they are with the caliber of those students. And the participating communities where third-year medical students will spend 9 months are Millbank, Mobridge, Parkston, Platt, and Winner. So that's very exciting, and we hope to have some good results from that. Another program is called the Rural Experiences for Health Profession Students, or the acronym there is REPS. And what that is it's a summer program, a four-week program where in 12 rural communities, pairs of students, so the total number of students is 24, that those students and the types of students are medical students, pharmacy students, physician assistant, and nurse practitioner. Those students go out in pairs to those communities. They spend 4 weeks and they are immersed in the community. They really can't even leave on the weekend unless they have a really, really good reason. But they're there together, and the community works hard to have them have a good experience. Finally, we've talked about educating students in South Dakota, making sure we have enough capacity. We've talked about making sure they have quality rural experiences. What do we do to recruit and retain them to actually practice here? There are two programs that the task force strengthened to actually do just that. The first one is called the Recruitment Assistance Program. And what this is a significant payment. Right now it's at about $172,000 to physicians and dentists who practice in a community of under 10,000. They have to have practiced for 3 years to be eligible for the payment, and the payment is split between the state and the community. A similar program for PAs, nurse practitioner, and nurse midwives, the amount is less. Another program, a $10,000 payment to nurses, respiratory therapists, physical therapists, dietitians who work in a community or work in a facility also in a community of 10,000 or less for 3 years. And I want to put Chairman Romkema and Senator Solano from the Appropriations Committee on notice that both of those programs, we've got a lot of people signed up for them, and the first year now that we'll be seeking payment for the second program is FY16, so we'll be talking to the Appropriations Committee. That's a good problem, though, a good problem to have that 60 slots were filled, and those students those practitioners have spent time 3 years in those eligible communities. So the healthcare workforce will always be a priority and a challenge for South Dakota. And one of our good partners working in this area is Dr. Jack Warner, the Executive Director of the Board of Regents.
I'm here to provide a partial answer to the question, what do you do with an undergraduate psychology degree? One of those fields that you wouldn't say there's a plethora of jobs in the job market. Well, one of the answers is you can become executive director of the Board of Regents. So that's my confession. My undergraduate degree was psychology. But we knew then, and a lot of undergraduates need to know, that if you're really going to major in some of the social sciences or arts or humanities degrees, you need to go on for further specialization to get more specific preparation in the job market, and that's certainly what I did with a couple of graduate degrees. So let me say a couple of things at the outset about what our public universities are doing to fuel the people power that we need in South Dakota to fuel the workforce. Each year, let's go back to the mid-1990s. In the mid-1990s, we were sending in South Dakota more high school graduates out of state to go to colleges and universities than we were importing from those other states. And so a collective mindset developed that there's brain drain happening. That was reversed, and now about 830 more high school students come to South Dakota to study than are leaving to study in other places. So we are importing high school graduate talent into our both public and private universities here in South Dakota for the purpose of study. About 31% of the total enrollment in the public universities come from out of state. And what's important about that is it's a real priority first to graduate them, and you've heard other stories about some of our efforts in that regard. But we retain about 32%. We find them in the workforce or in graduate school a year after they've graduated here in South Dakota. I call that a capture rate. So that's part of the larger initiative that the governor and my colleagues here on the workforce cabinet have described about importing talent and then trying to retain it. And I have to say, too, that one of the delights that I found in working in South Dakota is the collaboration that we have among our colleagues here. I have active collaborations with each of the people here. I'm on the Rural Healthcare Task Force. Melody and I have more collaborative efforts in dual credit and remediation and implementation of Common Core and a whole host of other things that than I could list here today. And we have a wage record matching system. The study I cited that found 32% of our out-of-state students, it also finds, by the way, 72% of the students who come to us from South Dakota, we find them in the workforce a year later. That comes from a wage record matching study that we do with DLR. But I'm going to shift gears just a little bit and talk about how we might retain even more of our graduates. And by the way, we produce about 5,000 graduates a year, 1,000 of which are graduate degrees. And so one of the questions is, how can we grow the high end of the South Dakota economy? And that brings us to the 2020 vision. South Dakota is an EPSCoR state. EPSCoR is a federal program. It's designed to support those states that have lagged behind other states in their research production and in the translation of research into commercialized ventures. About 30 states qualify for EPSCoR participation. And in order to qualify, you have to produce about every 5 years a coherent plan about where you're headed and what your vision is in taking research and producing viable high-end jobs that support both economic development and workforce development. And so the result of the last effort, and Regent Kathy Johnson was an active participant in this effort as a member of the advisory committee, we produced 2020 Vision, Science and Innovation Strategy for the state. And its purpose is promote innovation, grow knowledge-based companies, generate high-end jobs that will sustain our economy and our research growth. To provide some perspective, about a dozen years ago, the public universities were producing about $30 million in research expenditures each year, and that's grown to over $100 million now. When you hit $100 million, it's logical to ask the question, what kinds of research could translate into commercial ventures and other human capital building jobs in the economy? And so the 2020 vision looked to do that by generating ideas, looking at our current talent. And so part of the plan was, with the help of some consultants that came in and looked at the features of the South Dakota economy, was to generate targeted industry sectors that we could support through the research and commercialization efforts. And those consisted of advanced manufacturing and materials, healthcare, a very big one, because in addition to providing quality healthcare is a growing sector of the economy, particularly in pockets in the state, and we want to support that as well. IT and cybersecurity, we have particular strengths at Dakota State University in that. Value-added agriculture and agribusiness, it is one of the fundamental aspects of the mission of South Dakota State University to support the agriculture economy in the state. And energy and environment was the other major category. So one of the questions you ask when you generate a significant amount of research is, what forms of research might have the capacity to spin off into technology transfer and potential new businesses? So let me give an example from Heather Wilson's institution down the road. They have worked on a product called friction stir welding and cold fusion processing. This is a process that takes fatigued metal parts and makes them, through those processes, stronger than they were originally. So think of the applications for aircraft, for military vessels, and the commercial environment. The trick here is to see how to get the business acumen to the table and to get proof of concept funds that can stimulate the movement of that kind of a product into a viable company that can then expand, employ more people, and so on. because we want that end of the economy to be growing. So in collaboration with GOED, we have a proof of concept funding mechanism where we can fund research, market analysis, and patent funding to make it easier to put those potentially marketable companies out and among new expanding companies that will employ more people. We also had proposed an entrepreneur in residence program because many scientists are not business people, and they need the ability to rely on savvy business people to grow these ideas into viable companies. So finally, let me just describe another. The governor talked about training for specific jobs. And although we have a lot of majors and a lot of choices for students, most recently in collaboration with Eagle Creek Software, which is expanding from its base in Pierre and locating in Vermilion, we've designed in collaboration with them a four-course certificate program that any of our undergraduates can take, sign up for a paid internship, and then guaranteed employment at Eagle Creek following graduation. It's a good example of a very specific collaboration that we do with a company in order to fuel their workforce needs. They want to grow about 1,000 jobs in Vermilion. That's a challenge. So by using the 36,000 students that we have in the university system and giving them specific preparation, we can guarantee a job, not quite like China, but they'll have the choice of a guaranteed job at the end of that rainbow. So thank you very much.